I now would like to tee us up for our next panel, which is about unpredictable instability. And we heard from Secretary Albright this morning that unpredictability sometimes is really interesting, but unpredictability all the time is dangerous. And we've also heard a lot about the kinds of challenges that face us around the globe that include crises all around, from pandemics to the refugee flows to the new rise of great powers. So I'm delighted that we have a distinguished panel here today to talk to us about that. And I'd like to introduce our moderator, Charles Lane, who's a successful columnist for The Washington Post and a regular on Fox News Sunday. Please join me in welcoming Chuck Lane.
Well, it's, life is full of surprises, so it's a revelation to learn that I'm a successful columnist, but I appreciate hearing that. Thank you very much, and let's jump right in with our panel. And the first thing I'll do is just set the stage for you a little bit. I was talking to my two panelists who are Army guys about that old saying, no plan survives its first contact with the enemy. And I think many in administration, quite apart from armies, could testify to the truth of that aphorism. New presidents tend to come in with a big plan about how they're going to either change the previous foreign policy or change the world. And those administrations tend to find out that the world has other plans for them, and they're quickly encountered with the need to improvise and come up with a new plan to deal with the new reality. And so that's going to be our theme for this panel, and I honestly think couldn't come up with a better group of four people to address that issue. I will introduce them really quickly, and then we'll just jump in to preserve the maximum amount of time for your participation for questions from the audience later on. So, to my extreme left, not ideologically, but just over there on the left, is General Jack Keane, who, in addition to his very distinguished service in the U.S. Army, is now the chairman of the Institute for the Study of War. On his immediate right is Juliette Kayyem, who's a national security analyst for CNN. Then we have the brand new CEO of the World Bank, Dr. Kristalina Georgieva, who has just arrived at the World Bank in Washington. Just prior to that was in charge of humanitarian issues for the European Commission. And then right here on my left, again, these are not ideological references.
I'm very comfortable.
is Dr. James Carafano. He's the Vice President for Foreign and Defense Policy at the Heritage Foundation and has been helping out with the transition for the incoming Trump administration. So what I'd like to do in the first part of the panel is, starting with General Keane, ask each of the panelists to briefly give us their thought on where the surprise might come from. Now, obviously, if we could predict it, it wouldn't be a surprise, but we're going to try the exercise of trying to identify in advance what the black swan might be over the next 4 years facing the Trump administration. General Keane, you want to take
Charles,
that?
Thank you. Being my colleague up here mentioned this other network, I think it was described as CNN, is that what it was?
Yes. Yeah.
I just want to mention that Charles is a contributor on Fox News, as I am, and we are colleagues and proud to be associated with that particular network. Listen, I want to thank USIP for what you're doing here today. I think this is the third time that you've established this platform, and it makes a lot of sense to bring back the incumbent administration and those who are taking over. And there's obviously a transition experience going on that's divorced from this. But, you know, the public display that I saw some of it on the internet this morning between the principals in both administrations is really quite encouraging. We've had such a polarizing experience these last number of years that maybe there's some encouragement that our very foundation of what we all have in common together, virtually, even though we disagree on public policy, the fact that we all are very concerned about national security, protection of the American people, our basic freedoms, our values, we all have that in common. And we're willing to sacrifice quite a bit to assure it's accomplished. And that was very much on display today as we witnessed the principals from both administrations talking to all of you. So well done, USIP. There's a couple of certainties that's going to face a new administration. One is that they will have strategic surprise. That's a fact. This is the United States, a global leader, and we've had strategic surprise dramatically beginning in World War II all the way to the present. And the second thing is, despite our best efforts up here to predict what will be the strategic surprise of the Trump administration, if history is our guide, we will fail miserably, because no one has ever been able to predict the strategic surprise accurately of an incoming administration. But nonetheless, as we all know, and those who have served at 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue know, that the world has a way of coming to the doorstep of the White House, regardless of what their particular domestic agenda is or foreign policy agenda, and to a certain degree, it will move them possibly in a different direction. And that's the reality of it. You go back in history, and it's very pregnant how that impacted administrations post-World War II, the Korean War, no one expected it, the Bay of Pigs invasion, the Vietnam War, protracted war, and then we have the collapse of the Soviet Union, we have Saddam Hussein invading Kuwait, we have Milosevic fighting four wars in Europe, and the Europeans, at least for most of that, were sort of powerless to do much of anything about it. We have 9/11, to be sure, in the Bush administration, but we also have 15 years of protracted war since 9/11, which I would tell you also is a strategic surprise to most of us. We had the Arab Spring, another strategic surprise in the Middle East that has fundamentally changed the contours of the Middle East with failed states, civil wars. Radical Islamists only taking advantage of the conditions that exist there. So in my judgment, the main contour of what this administration will, I think, is facing is the fact that there are two growing powers in the world who want to change the fundamental international world order as we know it, and they are willing to take degrees of risk to achieve that because they believe it is in their national interest to do so at the expense of the United States and its allies. Why? Because they refuse to accept that world order, that international order that the United States had helped design post-World War II with the major institutions, one of them represented here on the stage, the IMF, the United Nations, political and military alliances throughout the world, so that the calamity of World War II, 100 million people killed, would not be repeated again. Those nations are certainly Russia and China. And one is a much more of a near-term problem, Russia and China considerably longer-term problem, but will be there. And I think this is most obvious to everybody sitting in the room, but it is there, and we have to deal with it and face it. In terms of something I think that may trouble us is the nexus of transnational actors and cyber technology. It is just a matter of time for transnational actors to acquire the technological means to attack our critical infrastructure. And as such, reversing that, because they're not a nation state, we don't have the capability that mutual assured destruction did with nuclear power to modify that behavior. In other words, they can attack our financial and banking infrastructure, they can attack our utility infrastructure, they can attack our transportation infrastructure. Those are critical infrastructures in the United States, and you know as well as I do, they are not properly defended as we speak today. The nuclear infrastructure of the United States is properly defended. I'm talking about military nuclear power, and also our military networks are properly defended. Nation states have already tried some of this, to be sure, and that's going to increase. But I think the most troublesome thing, because you can't stop the behavior except by attacking back at it, is a transnational actor, that nexus with that kind of technology. That is a potential surprise for us. And so we don't minimize it. Remember, Osama bin Laden, because we had Khalid Sheikh Mohammed in our jailhouse for so many years, we had a lot of information from him that he volunteered to us, you know, after the extended interrogation technique was applied, but nonetheless, he gave it to us. And one of the things we found out was the attack on the United States was driven by Osama bin Laden principally because he thought he could collapse our moral and political will by attacking our economic center, our military center, and our government center. He didn't understand the American people, to be sure. But nonetheless, it was a realistic strategic objective, at least from their perspective, to try. And that certainly is something that the transnational actors out there today would certainly want to take on. They have never, ever given up the idea of using WMD on the United States, any means to hurt and kill us. And certainly, if they can acquire cyber as a means to do it, I'm convinced they're going to do it.
General Keane. Juliette?
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here, and thank you for having me. So I came out of the Department of Homeland Security. I was Assistant Secretary there, so I thought I'd just lay out some of my thoughts. I know you're involved with the transition, and it's a funny department, and so thought I would lay out sort of where we were. I served on the transition for Obama from President Bush, and we got briefed on every super squirrely thing that was going on and every, you know, potential enemy. And of course, and we thought we had it down, right? And then, of course, the first real crisis ended up being this unknown virus known as H1N1, which was coming in from Mexico. There was no known vaccine at the time. And that's what is going to happen to the Trump administration. You're sort of thinking about one thing and then something borderless, transnational comes around. So I want to talk a little bit about more governance and some of the challenges ahead for a homeland, which is very different than I think when we talk about war or other issues, because it is still, I would say, a work in progress, although the department is much older and the apparatus is a little bit more refined. One of the issues that will certainly come up, and there's just going to be no question about it because it's very difficult to sort of undermine or limit the threat that we now face, is this sort of, you know, call it what you will, lone wolf, whack-a-mole terrorism, whatever, individuals who are more likely than not directed by ISIS, maybe inspired by ISIS. But what we're seeing in the more recent cases is what you might call sort of ISIS justified, people who have a lot of things going on, Muslim Americans or converts, we don't know what's up with Fort Lauderdale, who looking to ISIS to give them justification. So there's sort of three different ranges. I worry about the ISIS directed a lot less than the other two. And those will happen in the United States, but more specifically, they're going to happen in a state and then they happen in a city. And that is a very different dynamic than a wartime footing, because the challenge for Homeland Security is really a governance challenge in this country. It is 50 governors, all with their own opinions, 250 plus major cities, all with their own opinions, all with their own attitudes, all with their own budgets about how much they are going to prepare and respond to a threat that is very, very hard to predict and is showing up in places, you know, maybe in New York, but also Orlando, you know. So I think that that will continue to be a challenge, and how a new administration keeps governors who are focused on a lot of different things and mayors who are focused on, you know, the potential teacher strike and picking up the trash, how you keep them focused on public safety and security for an apparatus that is dealing with all sorts of other things. So that is going to be, I think, a challenge in terms of the sort of what we would call the intergovernmental aspects for any administration. And in the absence of a major event which can unify a country like 9/11, for, you know, the tragedy that unifies, these more individual cases are really sort of local responses in many ways. So we have to make sure that local and state public safety entities are ready to respond to the whatever, because we can't answer the whatever. We don't know what it's going to be. The second issue is the department itself. I know this is an international audience, but there's a lot of people domestically. We always say, oh, it's a new department. It's still figuring itself out, and it is. But it's also either in 4 or 8 years, it's not going to be so new. And so figuring out what lanes the department is in and what it's good at, I think, is not both a challenge and an opportunity for the new administration, because once again, we don't know, I can name 1,000 threats that could happen. Obviously, terrorism created a Department of Homeland Security and the apparatus that it helps fund on the state and local level, but we have everything from immigration to viruses to cyber attacks and other things. The third issue is going to be, I think, and the thing that might very likely challenge administration is some major natural event. And it will challenge the way we live in this country in the ways that the Hurricane Katrina did not. We seem to be rebuilding New Orleans as it is, or that Hurricane Sandy is just starting to. We could debate the causes or whatever. I'm not interested in that. But some city or state will be impacted in a major way. And I think that over the next 4 or 8 years, as an administration and as mayors and governors will begin to face whether we don't change the way we live in America. The challenge for our homeland security is, of course, its size, right? I mean, and that we promote flow. I mean, people always say, airport security, why can't we be more like Israel? I said, well, you put 900,000 people in the air every day, as the department does. That's a really hard comparison, right? You put tens of millions of people on subway systems. That's a really hard comparison to compare us to any country. We value the flow of people, goods, and ideas. There's going to be differences about how much flow you want. And I think the challenge ahead, in particular, with sort of mega storms or major events, will be, do we begin to think differently about how we live as a society and a country to protect communities and to protect, in particular, the sea coast? The Department of Homeland Security owns the Coast Guard, also owns FEMA. So it is going to be challenged, I think, sooner rather than later in a lot of these efforts.
Dr. Georgieva. Maybe an international perspective. You're sort of fresh off an experience where Europe certainly came in for a big surprise, a strategic surprise in 2015.
Well, I would start with a recognition that what is new in the world of crisis is not only that they are more frequent and more profound, but also they do not have good manners. They don't wait their turn. They come, they overlap with each other. And actually what is unpredictable, obviously we can't quite see, but we can do a much better job in scanning the predictable and being sure that at least the predictable is kind of under control. In my view, there are three things that we need to watch in 2017 very carefully. One, since I come from Europe, I cannot not say it. The elections in Europe. There are three very critical elections, March, April, and then in the summer, the Netherlands, France, Germany. What is going to be happening around the dates of these elections can have an unpredictable impact on the results. And actually, we have seen in Europe so far a remarkable resilience of democracies. I was in Belgium in Brussels on the 23rd of March when the attack in Brussels happened, and the reaction we all had was stand up, be counted. Our way of life is not going to be shaken. I went to their equivalent of the Kennedy Center, Bozar, to a concert, and the hall was packed. And many people were there to make a statement. But if we continue to have soft target attacks in Europe, would that have a risk? And I think this is something to watch very carefully. Secondly, I call it the belt of trouble, for a lack of a better word. But if you take the continent of Africa and you start from Mali, then northern Nigeria, then you go to Central African Republic, South Sudan, Somalia, this is kind of your belt. And then you have above the belt Libya, which we have forgotten to talk about, but it's there. And then if you cross in the Middle East, of course, Syria, Iraq, and then you go a little further to Afghanistan, all this is potentially a source of shock. Because the cumulative impact of this footprint of conflict on, by the way, and I didn't mention Congo, DRC, I mean, there is a deal. Would this deal halt, and what would be the impact of this deal not holding? So we have this to watch. I would add, you talk about natural events in the United States, but we haven't had recently a major drought either in the Horn of Africa or in the Sahel. The cycle of drought has shortened. The last one, when I was humanitarian commissioner, 2011, is it now just about time to be hit again? This we need to watch. And my third point would be the economy of the world. We have to recognize now, I'm with colleagues from the World Bank who were supposed to tell me we have a report coming at 4 o'clock. So whatever I say is embargoed for now. But we are coming with a report that basically says the growth projections for the world, not so fantastic. Obviously, we would see what may be a tax package in the US and what would be the impact of this package on growth. But we are in a world economy where if there is a big shock in a sizable country, and I'm not going to name them, but you can all think of who they may be, and then this is all combined in a multiplicity of crises. How are we prepared for it? And I guess the short answer is not so well. But to finish on a positive side, I think there is now a huge recognition in governments and institutions like mine, the World Bank, that scanning the horizon for the signs of trouble, being able to have a much more risk management frame of mind. This is the new normal. This is where we are to be. And hopefully, we would see every year doing better in the scanning the horizon, assessing risk, and taking appropriate precautionary action.
Thank you.
Yeah, I'm totally not going to answer the question.
Well, it was a depressing setup.
I want to actually answer a question which I think is more important, which is why I think, regardless of what the crisis that we don't know is, these guys might actually do okay. And I have three points for my optimism. One is the presidential transition law, because we've actually never done a presidential transition like this, because the law was in place in 2012, but they didn't transition anything. So this is the first time we've ever exercised the law. And I think fundamentally the law has done a good thing in a sense. It enables putting in place a rather substantial infrastructure before the election. And that's particularly important for a team that's coming in, which is outside of government, because we don't have shadow governments like a lot of parliamentary governments. So we don't have shadow ministers, and we don't have people that really understand the day-to-day governance of what's going on. And part of what a transition team does is actually pretty unglamorous. It's really like doing due diligence on an acquisition. It's explaining what you're taking over. And so what the law does, it really enables the folks who are out running on a campaign to fall in on some training wheels and to begin that process of transition, I think, much, much more efficiently than we've ever done before. And that, of course, was the intent after 9/11 to do that. And I think that's generally successful. So the second is this administration. I think this administration has really tried very, very hard to replicate the kind of effort that President Bush made in transitioning to President Obama. And I think they've done a very good faith job. I mean, certainly for the agency that I've been working with most closely, Department of Homeland Security, Jay Johnson's done a remarkable job. I mean, the Department of Homeland Security could not have been more helpful and productive in helping people understand what they were assuming command of. And I think that's generally true across government. I think it's been enormously helpful. And when you talk about passing the baton, literally there are actually people that are passing the baton and not talking about politics. And it's, I think, been very gratifying for me as an American citizen. The third thing is you know, on January 13th, they do a left-right exercise, crisis management exercise with the incoming and outgoing S1s, and as somebody who's worked in this stuff forever, you know, it's true. Mulkey said, you know, no plan survives contact with the enemy, but Eisenhower's corollary was, his plans are useless. But planning is everything. And so the notion is preparing to prepare is in itself maybe the best hedge against uncertainty. And they've made a lot of, I think it's a lot of progress. One area in particular is in dealing with a cybersecurity response. Because literally there was no plan. And over the course of 8 years, they've actually put together a cybersecurity response structure in the federal government. You could argue it's not perfect, it's not exactly maybe what you would want, but it was better than what we had before, which was nothing. And so that's one area of great concern that I think they've made good progress. And I would really, I would hope that they're not going to throw the baby out with the bathwater. So there actually has been good work in terms of putting the structure together on how to deal with uncertainty. And hopefully this team will pick that up from the last team and move forward on that. So I'm planning on going to sleep on January 20th and sleeping pretty soundly and waking up on the 21st and thinking the world will still be here. So.
What time are you going to sleep on the 20th?
Probably pretty early, yeah.
Well, thank you all for those really interesting comments. I warned you I might improvise, and I think you've already anticipated part of what we were planning to do in our second round of questions, which is to talk about the importance of crisis preparation and getting ahead of problems. I wanted to maybe get your reflection on something that Dr. Georgieva pointed out, which is, by implication, some of the uncertainty and some of the crisis in the next 4 years might come from the developed world, from this, what has, we've always thought of as the more stable areas of the globe. I hope it's not too risky to say the biggest shock maybe in world affairs this year was generated by the United States in our very own election. Certainly not a flood or an epidemic, but a big shock to people's expectations. And I'd like to ask each of you to reflect on that and ask whether we've reached a point in world affairs where we really can assume any particular area is a sort of a reservoir of stability, or whether this instability is maybe something that's been globalized along with everything else. Who wants to take a crack at that?
I'm going to start, because this brings a very interesting memory. 2011, maybe it was. I had a visitor in Brussels. At that time, I was in charge of humanitarian affairs and crisis response. And the visitor was Greg Fugatti, the FEMA administrator. Somebody who grew up in the ranks from a firefighter to run FEMA, and to my taste, very well. So I asked Greg, what are your priorities? And his answer was two. One, think of the unthinkable. Two, prepare the United States to receive international assistance if the unthinkable happens. And now, what shook me as a European was, I never thought I would live long enough to hear somebody from the United States to say, I want to prepare the United States to receive international assistance. But the point is that we actually are in a world where trouble travels, shocks, especially those that are caused by the evil of man, in a technologically connected world, and those caused by nature, they absolutely put us all on equal footing. Who is to say, I mean, if you remember, we in Europe not that long ago were victims of our own stupidity in the Second World War. And then we were the refugees. United Nations Agency for Refugees was created for us. Who is to say that in the world there wouldn't be a situation in which these shocks are to be there? But this being said, I just want to stress two very important things, because they lead to our responsibilities. One, developed countries may now be more at risk of multiplicity of shocks, but we are much better prepared. We are much more resilient because we have strong institutions, we have strong economies. And therefore, two, we have an obligation to work on resilience everywhere. Because if we don't, trouble travels. It is going to come and bite us in the butt.
That's a technical term. General Keane.
Yeah, I think that's almost self-evident, frankly, because we are part of the developed world. And as I mentioned, the two revisionist powers are trying to change the world order that we helped develop. We're going to be challenged. And that is already in evidence. Secondly, the terrorists, the radicals, their target is largely the developed world for similar reasons, because the developed world has global impact politically, economically, and socially. And they believe it's that pollution which has brought them to their radicalized ideology. So ultimately, we are always going to be their objective, and that is going to continue. With that part of the problem that we have, with the radicalization of people ideologically and religiously motivated to kill their fellow citizens or to kill others, this is a generational problem that we have not even come close to dealing with. We don't have a single alliance that I'm aware of to combat the problem. We haven't tried to develop a comprehensive strategy to deal with it. We have people in America that think we can develop a counter-ideology strategy to deal with the radicalization of largely Muslims. I find that to be quite absurd. I think we need to have the people who are involved in that and develop the counter-ideological arguments for religious people themselves, political leaders themselves, who are part of the nations where these conditions are allowed to fester and people become radicalized. But we definitely need, if we have a radicalized problem like I think we do, and we can describe it now as almost a global jihad, why aren't we not approaching the problem globally to deal with the ideology similar to we've done in the past? We did this with post-World War II, and we were intimidated by communist ideology. Every single European country that looked at that saw that as a formidable threat. And no country by itself could stand up against it, the Soviet Union and the Warsaw Pact. So we put together what? A political and military alliance, and developed a containment strategy that worked. And we were motivated by the intimidation, certainly, of that ideology and what it portended for all of our freedom-loving people. Where is that in dealing with this? We don't have it. And I think that's a sad commentary. This is why I'm encouraged about this administration. I'm not talking about politics now. I'm just talking about leadership. American leadership in the world has a role to play. And we can play a role here. We don't craft the strategy, but we can bring people together and say, look, we got to get organized here. We got to think through this problem. We do have a generational problem. These people are going to keep killing us. And we got to figure out a way to stop it. My profession can only do some of this. The kinetic solution is just a portion of it, and it has a rightful role to play to hold this horrific behavior accountable. It has an appropriate role to play. But I would suggest to you, it is a smaller role than what needs to be played to push back on the political and religious ideology. And that's where we got to get to. And thoughtful leaders of the world, I'm convinced, can do this. The American leaders, I think, we can help possibly organize that effort and empower it. We don't have to come up with the answers. They can come up with the answers.
Juliette?
So I just, you know, in response to your question about multiple crises and crisis preparation, we often talk about resiliency, and that sort of the word has sort of a zeitgeist, and everyone talks, oh, we just need to be more resilient. If we just did more yoga, we would all be fine, kind of attitude. And I think I should remind me every morning, but it doesn't work. But I want to remind people that resiliency is actually investments in. making cities stronger, response capabilities stronger, having interconnected systems of critical infrastructure built in a way that if the bad, so just assume that the bad thing is going to happen, because most of us in this field have to just assume that. How do you stop the cascading losses? How do you have fail-safe systems that stop the bad thing from happening? And I think that as we try to stop bad things from happening, which obviously prevention and mitigation are key, also these real investments in what it means to be built resilient. Does it mean that, you know, people in Manhattan, or in New York, like, you know, we just keep rebuilding the same way, like in the last, you know, it floods every time, or, you know, can we build subway systems that are stronger, or having to do with terrorism? You know, look, I came from Boston. I oversaw the Boston Marathon security planning up till 2 years before the Boston Marathon attack. We in Boston like to say, oh, Boston's strong, it's our Irish, you know, stock, that's what got it through it. BS. What got it through us is, well, three people died at the finish line. Over 300 people who were sent to hospitals did not die. Right, and that doesn't happen in crisis management. That ratio is too good to be true. And those were a lot of bad mistakes. But part of that was the training and investment in crisis management, in engaging a public health apparatus that was ready to surge capacity if something like that would happen. That is what strong and resilient is. You try to stop the three from dying and the attack that happens, but also invest real investments, cost money, in also trying to minimize the harm in a world in which we have to assume bad things will consistently happen, though we wish they wouldn't.
We're just about ready for our question and answer period, so I'd like the people who are going to be handling the mics to prep, but I want to give Jim a chance to say a word on that.
Actually, I want to go back to your original question, because I actually thought it's one of the true threads of bipartisanship that's gone through the last 2 days that I think should not be lost. Because what I hear from, you know, left and right, and conservative and progressive and Republican and Democrat, is nobody disputes the notion that the peace and stability of Europe, the Middle East, and Asia are all of vital interest to the United States. And you have to get equal attention to all three of those. Not that they all have to be the land of milk and honey or anything. Anybody expect that Middle East anytime soon? But the notion of a large regional disruption in any three of those regions is incredibly damaging to us. And job one of the next president is, whether you want to run the threat of radicalization or cyber or whatever, that all three are important, all three are equal importance, and you don't get credit for two out of three. So I think the notion of an Asian pivot, however it is inappropriate for the next president. And each region demands a different solution set and has to be dealt with its own turn, because I don't think you can make big global trade-offs to say, well, we'll divide up, you take this part of the world and I'll take that part of the world. Each region is going to have to be dealt with on its own, case, and obviously they're going to impact one another to some degree, but they each demand equal attention. And I do think that's bipartisan. I mean, we could argue about the specific sets of what you do, but I think there is broad recognition that we all need to roll up our sleeves and we need to care about all three.
Okay, thank you very much. I'm going to move a little bit, and I have my magic pen out here. If you see it pointing at you, it means it's your turn to ask a question. So I'm pointing at you, and when I point the magic pen at you, that also triggers your identifying yourself and then asking a succinct question.
It's one. Formerly Undersecretary of State in the Obama administration for economic growth, energy, and the environment. I'd just like to make two points and raise one set of questions. One is, arguably, over the last decade, the most serious crisis facing the industrialized countries has been the financial crisis. Because it not only had adverse financial circumstances, but very strongly adverse political circumstances, which we're still dealing with throughout the Western world, Europe and the United States in particular, which argues for the increased emphasis on maintaining the legitimacy and the credibility and the resilience of international financial and trade institutions. The second is that we discussed earlier today a whole series of strategic issues, but there was very little discussion of the role that increased trade and trade deals should play and had been anticipated to play, TTIP and TPP, in bolstering our alliances in the Pacific with TPP and our alliance in Europe with TTIP. Now, problem is my concern over the future, and if this is a bipartisan issue, it's not one or the other, because we saw in the campaign both candidates oppose TPP. My question in the future is, the incoming administration really would be weaker, and the United States would be in a worse position if there was not stronger support for global institutions, which were extremely helpful in 2007, 2008. If we let those institutions languish, if we don't give them support, it seems to me the world and the United States are much more vulnerable to a financial crisis or to a trade war. This, to me, is a big problem. The second, what does this administration do, and what does the Congress do? If we don't have TPP, if we don't have TTIP, what is the alternative to demonstrating to other countries that we are major players on trade, that we're reliable partners on trade and international economic issues? Then it seems to me it weakens our credibility, not just in the economic area, but on national security and on political issues as well. So I'd like to pose these two challenges to our panel. How do we strengthen the legitimacy of the international institutions on which we depend? And if we don't support TPP or TTIP, what do we do to demonstrate our trade credibility and therefore underpin our national security and our foreign policy credibility in Asia and in Europe?
So that's a lot to chew on. Who wants to take a shot at it?
Since it is, I'm here from one of the global institutions, I feel feel obliged to come on that question. Actually, I'm very happy to come on that question. Of course, in a world that is more interconnected and shock-prone, we need stronger buffers. We need the capacity, when a shock occurs somewhere, to very swiftly move resources and make sure that it is protected from, the rest of the world is protected from contagion. Just going back to the General Keane's a very good point on the necessity to deal with these threats at source, because militarily we can do, you can do some, but not everything. Is there anybody in the audience who, like me, was born on the other side of the Iron Curtain?
The Bronx?
The Bronx? Oh, that call? Oh, sorry.
A little further. That Iron Curtain in Europe. So I see people raising their hands. Look, how did you win the Cold War? You won it, of course, with smart strategy and engagement, but basically economically. You drove our system at that time, central planning, to its knees, and it went bankrupt, and we were free. Well, we need a similar massive investment in areas of instability. I think of my institution as the World Bank, as the critical investor in areas that otherwise would fall in the hands of bad people and stay there for a long time, as well as to pull these areas from the hands of bad people and bring them back to a more civilized place. But global institutions have also an obligation to be oriented towards the future, to make the investments that would make a difference in the world of tomorrow. And what are these investments? Well, first, we do need to assess economically and financially where the risks are and be able to put a price tag on them. And actually, the World Bank did a study, astonishing number, $14 trillion is the cost of conflict and violence to the world economy. Obviously, cutting this cost down on its own is a very good thing to do. But then we have to be much more creative, and this is my second point, in being able to lean forward at the time of crisis, anticipate crisis, act early, lean forward, so we prevent the crisis into sucking in world resources and creating instability. To do so, we must rely much more actively on these global institutions to create the environment for the private sector to step in. Because what gives me grief at night? What makes me not go to sleep? Just the idea of the demographic boom that is happening exactly in this belt of trouble I was describing. Nigeria turning into a 1 billion people country. Well, for that not to happen, or to happen without creating huge instability, we need jobs for people. We need, we need first education for boys and girls, and then we need jobs for people. We need people to stay where they are. And believe you me, from an European perspective, I saw how destabilizing it would be when people are on the move unexpectedly in big numbers. So to sum it up, I'm talking about my institution, the World Bank. I do see the World Bank today as necessary as it was after the Second World War, to make that investment in stability in the world in the way that creates a chance for us to cut down the cost of destruction and, of course, provide the buffer to the world, and not only from a security standpoint, also from a financial standpoint. I would leave the other panelists to venture on the topic of trade, so I don't take all the air in that question.
Well, I think we have a question here.
Eileen Shields West, Refugees International. So one of the most destabilizing forces in the world today is the large number, 65 million people who are displaced because of climate, conflict, or economic migration. And my question is, what are we, the U.S. is, do we perceive that as a threat and that we have a role in mitigating that threat, or are we relying on Europe to deal with it? As we know, that's not successful, or the neighboring countries who have Lebanon and Jordan and Turkey, of course. So Senator Kerry brought up the idea of a new Marshall Plan this morning, which would encompass Middle East, Africa, and Asia. Is that possible, doable? Is that even in the cards with the new administration?
I'll take that. I don't know enough about the new administration to comment in terms of what they would do, and I'm not sure anybody here truly does. But I would suggest this. First of all, thanks for the question. We have to go to what is causing that problem. We certainly have to treat it. The migration that we show explode in Europe, the 11 million people that are displaced in Syria is a real humanitarian crisis. I'm frustrated by the fact that it's allowed to linger as long as it has, based on our own public policy, to be frank about it. But these challenges that we have in the Middle East and the political, social, economic conditions that are essentially driving those challenges, we have to help our Middle Eastern friends deal with these problems. And we have to be very frank with them about some of these conditions that are there and help them shape the improvements that's necessary. The civil wars, the Arab Spring, has all grown up as a manifestation of those conditions. The social disenfranchisement, the lack of political participation, and the lack of economic opportunity are major drivers to the instability and turmoil that we see there. Yes, for something like the Middle East, some fashion of Marshall Plan, I would agree with Secretary Kerry on that, although I don't agree with some of his other public policies. Let me just full disclosure here as it comes to Syria and some of the other issues in the Middle East. But I definitely think we have to look at that entire area holistically, and given the millions of people that are under the age of 30, as you know, in that region, and the economic and social disenfranchisement they feel, this problem is going to get worse before it gets better. And, you know, you can look at the Middle East from an American perspective and wring your hands and say, this has gotten worse ever since we tried to do something about it. The best course of action is to just pull back and try to contain this problem as best we can and let them solve this themselves. This is not our problem to solve. We're culturally very different. The topography is very different. And this is much their problem. And That's 1935 Europe all over again thinking. Yeah. That's what that is. Yep. And that's being tired of World War I and not expecting Nazism, and that polluting ideology is going to contaminate anybody. It'll go away. Just leave it alone. And how horrible a mistake did those leaders, who were plagued by the experience of World War I, have to suffer as a result of it in terms of their people? We cannot afford to not do something about this problem. And it's going to take a lot of thoughtfulness and comprehensive strategy and participation with our friends in the region to do it. We've got to get the Europeans involved in it, because they are all touched by this crisis that exists there.
Juliette, do you want to say something?
Yeah, just quickly also, I mean, just in terms of the United States, I mean, really think of the South-North challenge that we're going to have, or if we don't have it already, with minors and undocumented minors trying to come here, and then also mass migrations after some catastrophe. I mean, look, when the Haiti earthquake happened, I know we like to feel good about ourselves and say we're going to deploy resources and help the Haitians. What really did animate all of the activity was an utter fear of a mass migration out of Haiti that would sort of show up on the shores of Florida. That's not a bad thing. I think it's important that we protect our borders, but that we have to continue to assist these countries that might face mass migration problems, not just from an altruistic, you know, de-conflict perspective, but also because those challenges will find their way here, just given how the United States so often serves as a magnet. We can try to close our borders, which, but, you know, the oceans are hard to close a lot of times.
We have a question here.
Hello, Sean Callahan with Catholic Relief Services. I wanted to ask you a little bit about values, and it sounds like a little bit what I'm hearing is a little bit of a bunker mentality of bunker America and protecting ourselves. And when I was studying history when I was young, one of the things that we were very proud of is we were the new world, and the old world was kind of stayed, and that new world was young and vibrant and energetic. And I was in Kenya a month ago and talking to some people, and they started describing us as the old world, that they were the young countries, that they were the vibrant ones, that Latin America was young countries as well, so those continents, and that we were more of a status quo power. So my question is, the fact that we have migrants coming here, to a certain degree, is a good thing, because we must be doing something right. But what is the importance of the values of that optimism and that energy, and that we don't close ourselves down, but open ourselves out and invest in the continent of Africa and Latin America and other places so that they see, feel, and have hope in the future and can trust in the United States, as opposed to thinking we're a status quo power out to protect ourselves?
Anybody want to tackle that?
It is very beautifully said. That what in the end determines our choices is who we are. And one thing I learned when I was Commissioner for Humanitarian Aid, going to these devastated places, was that Europeans, Americans, the people from this old world, very good people, very, very generous, willing to put their lives at risk to save the lives of others. But somehow, talking about being goodness is being good, is not, it doesn't cut through. Goodness tends to be quiet. Evil, very loud. And you're right that what makes us so strong is we do have this core values of solidarity, sharing the opportunities with others. And we have to amplify this voice of goodness. But we also have to be mindful that our people in our countries are anxious. They're anxious for reasons. And not look with disrespect to this anxiety. And look for solutions that are based on these values, but they are also good for my neighbors and my family, for their comfort, for their strength of mind. And by the way, I just wanted to say that retired General Flynn, in an interview with Farid Zakaria, talked about the Marshall Plan. He is the forthcoming National Security Advisor. He talked about the necessity to invest very heavily in the countries that are most conflict prone. So it resonates very much with the position we have taken on this panel. But thank you for bringing that up.
We have a question there.
Ali Baki from the Woodrow Wilson Center. We talked about the strategic surprises, and General Keane said that we can never predict those crises. But what I would like to do is actually give you a concrete example and see how you would respond. And Juliette already started mentioning with Haiti, but state collapse is clearly one of the things that we are facing. And then Venezuela is probably the country that is probably nearest to the United States that will collapse very soon. Imagine a situation where you have a collapse of the state in Venezuela with civil war, the government killing lots of people, lots of refugees, and it's close to the United States, close to Mexico, Colombia, etc. What would you recommend the new administration to do in a situation like that?
Or
easy.
If I could add, he's talking about possible crisis in Venezuela. What ought to be done to prepare for it right now, as well as to cope with it if and when it happens? You want to try that, Jim?
I General.
In terms of which was your second question, in preparing for the future, any new administration, most importantly from a national security perspective, has got to develop a national security strategy, not something that's thrown in a whole box and nobody reads, but something that's thoughtfully put together that actually becomes the foundation of the work that you're about to do on behalf of the United States. And then you have to have the processes that support all of that and the objectives that you're trying to achieve and some accountability for that. This is organizational stuff that is boring as all daylights, but it really makes a difference. And you can see when you look at the NSC and how it operates differently under administrations and how some operate considerably better because these systems are in place. And another thing I think the interagency should do is something it's embedded in me because of my years of experience with the military. One of the reasons why we're able to deal with different enemies as well as we can is because we prepare so much based on different scenarios, as we call it. So we don't call it crisis management, but we do this kind of crisis management against different enemies so that we're prepared to deal with the unexpected as a natural condition of warfare. And therefore, I believe we likely do it better than anybody in the world. However, most government entities, even those that deal with crisis management, don't do that because they use the excuse that day-to-day business is too much, too consuming, and we're never going to be able to get the principals involved. And we got to get past that. And only when you can get the attention of the principals can this really work. And I would suggest that that is something that possibly General Flynn, with his military background, I haven't had this conversation with him, could maybe put in play so that you can deal with a crisis like Venezuela or a problem with nuclear weapons in Pakistan. We can make a laundry list of things that need to be done, and I'll just stop there. Somebody else go to contribute.
You had this experience in Europe of being all of a sudden faced with a massive displacement of people and basically economies in our region in huge trouble. I would say do Europe on steroids. Do what Europe did much faster. What Europe did in the end is exactly the right thing. Massive financial package for the countries in the region that are in trouble, where refugees come from, or are hosting refugees. Reinforcement of the border control so we know who is coming and we can give some comfort to the population that we know who is coming. And fast assessment of where in the European economy people actually can find jobs, be prepared to do that. When we have the situation you describe, a country that is facing political collapse is what your scenario, then of course it is the politics that needs to be fixed. But if there is no massive financial assistance, then fixing it would be costlier over medium term and less likely to be successful. And of course, domestic politics is domestic politics. It would be for the people there to figure it out. But if they're left on their own, they pay a very high price. The rest of us pay a very high price. We did it in Europe over a period of 18 months. For fairness to us, I don't know a country that or a region that would have a million people coming, and this would not be a shock. But we have to be much faster. We have to be much less wishful thinking in kind of saying, I wish it to go away. Concentrate on a solution and act very quickly.
I think we have about enough time for one more question, which is good because we have one more question. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. John Norton Moore from the University of Virginia. My comment actually relates to an earlier period in which I had the great privilege of being the first chairman of the board of the United States Institute of Peace. And I had a wonderful time in talking to Senator Spartan Matsunaga, a leading Democrat, about what he wanted for this great institution. And then sitting immediately next to Ronald Reagan, the then President of the United States, a wonderful Republican, about what he wanted from this institution. And I believe that Spartan Matsunaga and President Ronald Reagan would just be enormously pleased and excited to see the wonderful success of this institution that was literally created by them in that period, and then all of the wonderful leadership that it currently has had with all the many chairmen and others. This wonderful little agency is doing extraordinary work that I think needs to be more broadly called to the attention of the world generally, not just the American people. Second general comment is one of the things I think as a concept that needs to be put on the table somewhat more strongly than I've heard it today, as we all seek the things I think that we share in common. We would like to see greater economic development. We would like to see a reduction in conflict and war. We would like to see greater human rights. We would like to see far greater health and wellness generally for people around the world. But we know the aggregate of things that actually correlates with all of those things more strongly than virtually anything else we've found. It is democratic governance, the rule of law, good governance generally. And so I would suggest that one of the things we need to be talking about is not just a Marshall Plan, it is the question of how do we actually get out there much more effectively in promoting democracy, rule of law, and good governance, and that we not forget the enormous importance of those things as we think about this, for example, let's say in realist terms, but that we understand realistically the thing that really does correlate are all of these things relating to governance, and we see so much of this now. A few years ago, there was a very, very fine proposal to create a democracy rule of law training center for all of Africa that would be funded half by the United States AID, that would be funded half by the European Union. I still think that would be one of the single most important things you could do in trying to assist Africa. That would then be turned over in a short period to the African Union. But I hope that we put on the table in all of our discussions democracy, rule of law, good governance.
Can I just, yes. I, I'm a secret closet fan of USIP and a Steve and Nancy thing, but I don't want that to get out in public. But I want to run up to my comment about why I'm a fan, because I think it relates to your comment, which is I hate. We need an interagency solution. I hate those things, right? This notion that we can only solve a problem if everybody freaking gets involved. I don't know how many people have been involved in government, but when they say whole of government, I really kind of blink, right? I think the answer is, whether it's governance or development, what you need is the right combination of tools at the right time, in the right place to get the job done. And it's not always a trope of a Marshall Plan or something else. Sometimes it might be a very finesse sort of instrument. And so one of the reasons why I love USIP, particularly what Nancy and Steve have done, is what they have done in some ways in very humble ways is they put together some tools for the toolkit, which don't fit in kind of traditional big government programs, don't necessarily aren't the thing you would find in an NGO, but they live in that little shadow space in between where somehow that's just kind of a nice tool and just the right piece to fit in there. So I'm a fan because it adds more tools to the toolkit. And I actually don't like this notion of when we have a problem, we need to throw up a toolkit and just start throwing tools at it. Because sometimes what the world needs is not an architect, it needs a craftsman. And in a lot of these problems, I would actually disagree with maybe a lot of things that we need big and more and everything. And in cases, there are a lot of cases where what we need is a craftsman with the right set of tools. And a lot of times, it's tools are exactly the kind of things that Nancy and Steve and the folks here are doing. But I never said that.
I'm glad you concluded on a construction metaphor. Real estate development is a very relevant thing these days in America. And this conference has come in on time and under budget, right at 3:45 p.m., this panel, I should say. So join me all in giving some appreciation to our panelists.